Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you.
Welcome to John Live!
There's a city that calls me by name. There's a city that calls me by name.
Yes,
Welcome to church online. There's a city that calls me by name. There's a future that runs through my veins. There's a future that runs through my veins. And there's nothing on earth that could stand in the way. There's a future that runs through my veins.
Well, good morning. I'm Michael, and welcome to the Church at Maltby and Monroe Online. We're so glad to have you with us today. I love that we can gather together in person, but I love that we have the ability to also gather together online at this time. So sit back and get comfortable. Here's what we're going to do today. We're going to have some songs that you can watch and listen to and maybe sing along with so we can worship together. We're going to have a message so we can learn and grow in God together. And at the end, we'll have a time to respond to that message by talking to God in prayer. Then we'll close out with some resources to help you get connected throughout the week. So enjoy.
Let all agree, there's no power like the power of
afraid. No, I don't want to be afraid. I don't want to fear the storm just because I hear it roar. No, I don't want to fear the storm. I don't want to fear the storm. Peace, be still. See the word and I will set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace, be still. You are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. I'm not gonna be afraid, 'cause these waves are only waves. I'm not gonna be
Well, it's great to be with you, as always. Love having you join us and learn from God's word or whatever God's speaking to our hearts. Always a great time. Today, we're going to consider the Jesus story and our stories from eternal perspective, if you will. And we're going to do that by looking at some what some call the Great Commission. I'm sure you've heard that phrase before, the Great Commission. The instruction, you know, to Jesus people or Christ followers to share basically the Jesus story, to share the gospel. The idea is that if we are disciples or followers of Jesus, then we should be discipling others. We should be leading others into a relationship with Christ, but also discipling them in that relationship. We see in the scriptures when Jesus called the 12, and then, of course, later at the end of his ministry, to the 11, because Judas has betrayed him and he's no longer around. After the resurrection, he instructs his followers, right, with these words, Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Again, this is what's kind of called the Great Commission. He says, Therefore, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Yeah. So as followers of Jesus, as Christians, that mission continues through his followers, through you and through me. We are to be the light of Jesus in the world, the light of Jesus to those in, say, our circle of influence, you know, to our friends, to our family, you know, in our neighborhoods, on our teams, if you are on one, you know, in the workplace, in the marketplace. Yeah, wherever God has put you in life, you are called to be sharing the light of Jesus, the good news, the story of Jesus. We read in the book of Acts, chapter 13, verse 47, these words. It says, "For the Lord gave us this command when he said, I have made you a light. I have made you a light to the Gentiles," those that don't believe, "to bring salvation to the furthest corners of the earth." Christians, Jesus' people, are on the mission of God, or at least we should be, to rescue people, you know, with the saving message of love and grace that Jesus offers to each and every person. But there's more. We read in Acts 1:8 that he empowers us to do just that. He says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses." We're going to bear witness what Jesus has done in our lives, what he's done, right? "Telling people about me everywhere," goes on to say, "in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." So what's it talking about here? It's talking about, so Jerusalem speaks of, say, how does that equate to us? Jerusalem speaks of your community, right? Your community and mine. And then beyond that, say, to Judea and Samaria, it's progressively going further and further and further. And then, of course, to the ends of the earth, taking the Jesus story even further and further. One could kind of think of it as local, regional, national, and global, the message of Jesus going out. Now, we all know that we can't all go to the ends of the earth, right? But some are called to do just that. Some are called and they go to those places that maybe you and I aren't called to go to. But so it's our privilege, I guess what I'm trying to say, it's our privilege and it's our responsibility then to help them out, by praying for them, by supporting them financially so that they can go, so they can go to places, say, we can't go. That's why the church at Maltby Monroe, we encourage every person to get involved in missions, to get involved in a faith promise, you know, where we believe God for an amount, we pray and we believe God for an amount that then he speaks to our hearts, right, about what we should give. And then by faith, we step out each month and we give what we believe he's saying. We support missions, right, each month as the Lord provides, whether it's you know, $5 a month or 50 or 500 or some other amount, we can all do our part. We can't maybe all do the same amount, but we can all sacrifice together. We can all do something to support those that are going out and giving up their comfortable lives, if you will, to serve as missionaries around the world. I like to call them strategic partners, as they go out and tell the Jesus story and what Jesus has meant in their lives. You know, in our live church gatherings today, we're going to have one of those strategic partners, one of the missionaries that we support. And her name is Joyce. And she's going to be sharing her story of God's faithfulness as she serves in a very, very sensitive country. It's so sensitive that I can't even share her full name or where she specifically actually serves in ministry. But I'll just ask you, since you're not going to be here today for that, pray for Joyce. Would you pray for Joyce, that pray for protection and provision and for fruitful, effective ministry as she shares the love and hope of Jesus in that sensitive country. Today, I want to share a story with you that I believe will bolster your faith. It's a missionary story, and I hope it touches your heart as much as it did mine. And I want you to listen on purpose, because I'm just basically going to read it and let the story speak for itself. So what might God be saying to you through this incredible story? It's a miraculous event, let me tell you. At the end of the story, I think we'll begin to grasp what, you know, that we need to maybe look at life here on this earth from an eternal perspective rather than a temporal one. This story is told by a woman by the name of Aggie Hurst, and these are her words. Let me tell the story. Back in 1921, a missionary couple named David and Svea Flood went with their two-year-old son from Sweden to the heart of Africa, to what was then called the Belgian Congo. They met up with another young Scandinavian couple, the Ericssons, and the four of them sought God for direction. In those days of much tenderness and devotion and sacrifice, they felt led of the Lord to go out from the main mission station and take the gospel to a remote area. This was a huge step of faith. At the village of Endolera, they were rebuffed by the chief, who would not let them enter his town for fear of alienating the local gods. The two couples opted to go a half a mile up the slope and build their own mud huts. They prayed for a spiritual breakthrough, but there was none. The only contact with the villagers was a young boy who was allowed to sell them chickens and eggs twice a week. Svea Flood, a tiny woman of only 4 feet 8 inches tall, decided that if this was the only African she could talk to, she would try to lead the boy to Jesus. And in fact, she succeeded. But there were no other encouragements. Meanwhile, malaria continued to strike one member of the little band after another. In time, the Ericssons decided they had enough suffering and left to return to the central mission station. David and Svea Flood remained near Endolera to go on alone. Then, of all things, Svea found herself pregnant in the middle of the primitive wilderness. When the time came for her to give birth, the village chief softened enough to allow a midwife to help her. A little girl was born, who they named Ina. The delivery, however, was exhausting, and Svea Flood was already weak from bouts of malaria. She lasted only another 17 days. Inside David Flood, something snapped in that moment. He dug a crude grave, buried his 27-year-old wife, and then took his children back down the mountain to the mission station. Giving his newborn daughter to the Ericsons, he snarled, "I'm going back to Sweden. I've lost my wife, and I obviously can't take care of this baby. God has ruined my life." With that, he headed for the port, rejecting not only his calling, but God himself. Within 8 months, both the Ericsons were stricken with a mysterious malady and died within days of each other. The baby was then turned over to some American missionaries who adjusted her Swedish name to Aggie and eventually brought her back to the United States at age 3. This family loved the little girl and was afraid that if they returned to Africa, some legal obstacle might separate her from them. So they decided to stay in their home country and switch from missionary work to pastoral ministry. And that is how Aggie grew up in South Dakota. As a young woman, she attended North Central Bible College in Minneapolis. There she met and married a young man named Dewey Hurst. Years passed, the Hurst enjoyed a fruitful ministry. Aggie gave birth to a daughter and then a son. In time, her husband became president of a Christian college in the Seattle area, which happens to now be Northwest University right here in Kirkland. Aggie was intrigued to find so much Scandinavian heritage there. One day, a Swedish religious magazine appeared in her mailbox. She had no idea who had sent it, and of course, she couldn't read the words. But as she turned the pages, all of a sudden, a photo stopped her cold. There in a primitive setting was a grave with a white cross, and on the cross were the words, Svea Flood. That would be her mother's grave. Aggie went straight to the college faculty member who she knew could translate the article. "What does this say?" she demanded. The instructor summarized the story. It was about missionaries who had come to Endelera long ago, the birth of a baby, the death of a young mother, the one little African boy who had been led to Christ, and how after the missionaries had all left, the boy had grown up and finally persuaded the chief to let him build a school in the village. The article said that gradually he won all his students to Christ. The children led their parents to Christ. Even the chief had become a Christian. There were 600 Christian believers in that one village, all because of the sacrifice of David and Svea Flood. For the Hearst's 25th wedding anniversary, the college presented them with the gift of a vacation to Sweden. There, Aggie sought to find her real father. An old man now, David Flood had remarried, fathered 4 more children, and generally destroyed his life with alcohol. He had recently suffered a stroke. Still bitter, he had one rule in his family: never mention the name of God, because God took everything from me. After an emotional reunion with her half-brothers and half-sister, Aggie brought up the subject of seeing her father. The others hesitated. "You can talk to him," they replied, "even though he's very ill now. But you need to know that whenever he hears the name of God, he flies into a rage." Aggie was not deterred. She walked into the squalid apartment with liquor bottles everywhere and approached the 73-year-old man lying in a rumpled bed. "Papa," she said tentatively. He turned and began to cry. "Ina, I never meant to leave you. I never meant to give you away. It's all right, Papa, she replied, taking him gently into her arms. God took care of me. The man instantly stiffened. The tears stopped. God forgot us all. Our lives have been like this because of him. He turned his face back, and then he turned his face back to the wall. Aggie continued, undaunted. Papa, I got a little story to tell you, and it's a true one. You didn't go to Africa in vain. Mama didn't die in vain. The little boy you won to the Lord grew up to win that whole village to Jesus Christ. The one seed you planted just kept growing and growing. Today, there are 600 African people serving the Lord because you were faithful to the call of God in your life. Papa, Jesus loves you. He has never hated you. The old man turned back to look into his daughter's eyes. His body relaxed. He began to talk. And by the end of the afternoon, he had come back to God. He came back to the God he had resented for so many decades. Over the next few days, father and daughter enjoyed warm moments together. Aggie and her husband soon had to return to America, and within a few days, David Flood had gone into eternity. A few years later, the Hearsts were attending a conference in London, England, where a report was given from the nation of Zaire, the former Belgian Congo. The superintendent of the national church, representing some 110,000 baptized believers, spoke eloquently of the gospel spread in his nation. The word gospel, again, simply meaning the good news of Jesus. Aggie could not help going to ask him after if he had ever heard of David and Svea Flood. Yes, madam, the man replied in French, his words then being translated, of course, into English. It was Svea Flood who led me to Jesus Christ. I was the boy who brought food to your parents before you were born. In fact, to this day, your mother's grave and her memory are honored by all of us. He embraced her in a long, sobbing hug. Then he continued, you must come to Africa and see because your mother is the most famous person in our history. In time, that is exactly what Aggie Hearst and her husband did. They were welcomed by a cheering crowd of villagers. She even met the man who had been hired by her father many years before to carry her back down the mountain in the hammock cradle. The most dramatic moment, of course, was when the pastor escorted Aggie to see her mother's white cross for herself. Later that day in the church, the pastor read from John chapter 12, verse 24, where Jesus says, I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. He then followed that up with Psalm 126:5. Those who sow in tears will reap with songs of joy. Aggie wrote her story in 1986. That's 25 years ago. What an incredible, miraculous story. And the mission of Jesus continues, folks. In Zaire, the gospel continues to grow, which is now called, by the way, the Democratic Republic of Congo. We have many missionaries from our movement, the Assemblies of God, who continue to serve there to this day. And as of 2018, roughly 96% of the population consider themselves to be Christians. Wow. Svea Flood gave everything. Why? Because Jesus gave everything for her. And Jesus gave everything for us, for you, and for me. How do we respond to that? How do you respond to that? Are we listening to God's Spirit speak to us so that we're living a missional life each and every day? Are we listening to God's Spirit who may be calling us to maybe even be a missionary as he did the floods and the Erickson's so many years ago? Whether it's a call to be a pastor or a missionary or whoever it is, God wants you to serve him. We have this message of rescue from spiritual death to spiritual life, all through the saving work of Jesus Christ. And we have the privilege and honor of sharing in his mission so that every person has the opportunity to hear the Jesus story. Let's pray, and then we're going to take communion together. Well, Jesus, we thank you for your incredible love for us, that you offer us forgiveness and new and eternal life. We thank you that you have entrusted us as your followers to bring your saving message to the world. And Lord, forgive us for sometimes being apathetic about that. Forgive us for letting fear and pride stop us from living and sharing the good news. And Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Empower us to be your messengers to our world. Just as we read in this story, Lord, sometimes we feel like nothing's happening through our lives, but yet miraculous things are happening. You're doing incredible things. People are being saved. So help us, Lord, to remember that. And Jesus, as we take communion together and we reflect on your sacrifice, Lord, remind us that we need to live sacrificial lives for you. Remind us of the price that you paid to pay the penalty of our sin and our shame. Remind us, Lord, that you gave your life so that we might have life, life eternal. That your body was broken, your blood was shed so that we could be saved and redeemed, so that we could live for you, and so that others might come to know you and live for you as well. In your precious name, Jesus, we pray these things. Amen. We're going to take communion. So if you're not prepared, you could pause this right now. And you could go get yourself some bread, some crackers, some juice, representing the wine. And we can take communion here together. So go ahead and prepare yourselves for that. All right. This is always a special time where we remember the sacrifice Jesus has made for our great salvation. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And he purchased that salvation by giving his life, by spilling his blood on the cross, so that our sins could be forgiven and we could receive that wonderful gift of eternal life, that wonderful relationship with God. So I would encourage you right now to take the bread, take the cracker. It represents Christ's body that is broken for us. Let's take it with thankfulness as we remember what he has done. And of course, if you have the cup ready, we drink the wine or the juice. It represents Christ's blood, Jesus' blood that was shed for us for the the remission of our sins and the new covenant that's purchased. And so let's take the cup together. Praise the Lord. Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for your body that was broken for us, for your blood that was shed for the remission of our sins. We're just so grateful. We endeavor to live our lives for you as we move forward, as we endeavor to be a light for you, Lord God. We want to have that missionary fervor that we read about in other people's lives. We want to see you do miracles through our lives, Lord, as we march forward, Lord, because of what you have done, the relationship that we have now because of you. Lord, we want to bring other people into that relationship as well. So God, just help us. Bless each one, we pray, in your precious holy name. Amen. Amen. Well, you have a wonderful rest of your day and a great week. And let's just always be tender and sensitive to what God is saying through the Holy Spirit to our lives, what he's calling us to do, what he's calling us to be. Take advantage of the opportunities he's given us. Who knows what miracle God might be doing with those very encounters when we think, oh, nothing's happening. No, God is always doing incredible things. God bless you. Have a great week.
I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. Oh, everywhere I go, on this road, high and low. Where I go with you. So I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. Where I go with you. I go with you.